again, B here, and welcome back to biology. Have you ever heard the phrase, there's an exception to every rule? Today's lesson is all about those exceptions. We've talked a lot so far about Gregor Mendel and his laws of inheritance. He definitely got genetics off to a good start, but as we've learned more, it's become apparent that there are many exceptions to his rules that he couldn't have known about at the time, given the limits of knowledge and technology. One rule that Mendel is famous for coming up with is the binary nature of alleles, meaning one is dominant and the other recessive. After all, his pea plants could either be tall or short, never a medium height. And flowers were always purple or white, never a soft lavender. But if those rules were true for all traits and all organisms, then humans would only have two possible hair colors. There would be no adorable calico cats, and we might not even have beautiful pink flowers. Clearly, something else is going on with the genes that control a large number of traits we are familiar with. It turns out that Mendel's laws do work for many traits, but the expression of others is more complex than what he observed in his pea plants. Traits that do not follow his rules of inheritance are called non-Mendelian traits, and they will be the focus of our lesson today. Before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to predict the possible phenotypes associated with heterozygous genotypes when alleles show incomplete dominance, and explain how multiple alleles and polygenic traits can lead to greater diversity of phenotypes in organisms. Mendel's idea of dominant and recessive alleles seemed revolutionary at the time, as it had previously been thought that traits were inherited in a blended fashion. And in the early 1900s, Carl Correns showed that the blended inheritance model hadn't been completely wrong in some cases. He experimented with several types of flowers and conclusively showed that red flowers crossed with white flowers produced offspring that were 100% pink, not a single red or white in the bunch. Red was considered dominant, but it wasn't completely dominant. Organisms with only one red allele instead of two were a much more muted version of red, which we know as pink. Let's see how this cross would have looked in a Punnett square. Because neither trait is completely dominant, we sometimes don't use capital and lowercase letters for the alleles. Instead, we'll use CR for red and CW for white. The C is to remind us that the trait is color, then an R or W for red or white. Both parents were purebreds or homozygous for either red or white, so we can fill in their genotypes on the top and left of the table. We fill in the boxes as we always do, look up and look left. Notice that each box has the same genotype, CRCW. All of the offspring will be hybrids or heterozygous. And because red is not completely dominant, all of the offspring have the pink phenotype. So there is no way for a cross between a red and white flower to produce any red or white flower offspring, only pink. Anytime the heterozygous genotype results in a trait that is somewhere in between the two homozygous traits, this is known as incomplete dominance. Mendel didn't happen to see any examples of incomplete dominance when he studied his pea plants, but it turns out that many traits behave this way. Human hair is a great example. How do you think wavy hair comes about? It's the combination of a straight hair allele and a curly hair allele. Neither is dominant over the other, so the result is somewhere in between. A similar example occurs with chickens and the allele for black or white feathers. Heterozygous chickens are speckled, having a mixture of both black and white feathers. When both traits can be seen simultaneously, it is known as codominance, though in some cases it is difficult to distinguish between incomplete dominance and codominance. For example, look at the offspring of a red horse and a white horse. It has a color known as roan. At first, it looks like a color in between red and white, but close inspection shows that the red and white hairs are still there individually. So this is codominance, as opposed to incomplete dominance. Because they are so similar, you will sometimes hear the terms used interchangeably. We know that any individual organism, including you, can only have two copies of an allele for a gene, because you get one from mom and one from dad. For the traits we've looked at so far, there were two possible alleles, so you either had two of the same or one of each. But what if there were three possible alleles that you could have? We'll call them A, B, and C for now. You might have two A's, or you might have an A and B, or a B and C, or a C and A, or two B's, or two C's. Suddenly, there are a lot more possible combinations. A good example of a trait with multiple alleles is the human blood type. There are three possible alleles, A, B, or O. The phenotypes, or blood type groups, that result are A, B, O, and AB. With more than two alleles, how do we know which is dominant? In this case, there is codominance between A and B, but both A and B are completely dominant to O. Our blood types are actually determined by the presence or absence of certain antigens in the blood cell. The A allele codes for the A antigen, while the B allele codes for the B antigen. The O allele does not code for either, which is why it's recessive to both A and B. You only need one copy of the A or B allele to make the A or B antigen. And if you have both the A and B alleles, you'll make both antigens. So how do we end up with different blood types from our parents? If you guessed that we're going to need a Punnett square, you're right. Let's look at the possible offspring for two parents with the genotypes AO and BO. Remember that O is recessive, so these parents would simply have the blood types A and B. To solve the Punnett square, we place the parental genotypes on the top and left of the table and fill in the boxes to see what possible genotypes the offspring could have. Then we determine their phenotypes, remembering that A and B are dominant to O, and codominant with each other. So an AB genotype is simply the AB blood type. BO is the B blood type. AO is the A blood type, and OO is the O blood type. From these two parents, any of the four blood types are possible in equal probabilities. So they'll just have to wait until the baby is born to have their blood tested to find out which alleles they got. It turns out that many traits have more than two possible alleles, and this is partly responsible for the vast amount of diversity we see within species, like the different fur colors in rabbits or the eye color in Drosophila, also known as fruit flies. Why in the world are we talking about fruit flies? Well, it turns out that they are one of the most commonly studied animals in genetics. You'll see more examples with them in the lesson PDF. Another example of non-Mendelian inheritance exists in the form of polygenic traits. These are traits that are controlled by multiple genes. Skin color is a great example of this. Most of the color in your skin is the result of pigment called melanin. Pigments are made from proteins, and what tells our body how to make proteins? Genes, of course! If there was only one gene for melanin production with simple dominant recessive alleles, either you would have melanin or not. This would lead to exactly two skin colors in humans, light or dark. Obviously, we know there is much more variety in human skin colors, and that's because it's controlled by multiple genes. Scientists have identified over 100 genes that code for the production of melanin. You can imagine your melanin genes as being a long line of on and off switches. The more switches that are turned on, the more melanin your cells will produce. Having the melanin allele turns the switch on, and not having the allele keeps it off. Although, our switches might actually need a medium setting, because while the allele for melanin is considered dominant, genes with only one melanin allele don't tend to produce as much melanin as genes that are homozygous for melanin production. So its dominance is not complete. In case this didn't give us enough variety already, there are also a few different forms of melanin that produce slightly different hues. So skin color has more variety than just light and dark. It's the result of many genes either producing various forms of melanin or not, and all of those produced pigments combining to make the final color. Why do you think there is so much variation in skin color? It's most likely an adaptation based on where your genetic ancestors are from. Parts of the world that receive more UV rays from the sun tend to have a larger number of melanin alleles in their gene pool, most likely as an adaptation that protects skin from sunburn and skin cancer. In parts of the world where UV rays are not as much of a threat, less melanin proves to be the better adaptation, as it doesn't block the absorption of sunlight that is needed for vitamin D production. Like many things in life, melanin represents a trade-off. Avoid sunburns by having plenty of it, or get enough vitamin D by having less of it. Turns out, it's really hard to do both. And there are many other examples of polygenic traits, both in humans and other species. Your height, hair color, and eye color are all polygenic. Even your risk of cancer depends on hundreds of different genes. We mentioned a few of the common ones during our lesson on mutations, but scientists are still finding more. Our bodies are complex and full of interactions between different types of cells and proteins, so it's no surprise that many of these proteins would work together to determine our traits. During our lesson today, we looked at examples of incomplete and codominance, where the trait of the heterozygous genotype is different from either of the homozygous genotypes. It might be somewhere in the middle, like pink resulting from red and white, or a combination of both, like having black and white feathers. We also saw examples of genes with more than two possible alleles, like the human blood types. And we looked at polygenic traits, like skin color, that are controlled by multiple genes. There is one other type of non-Mendelian inheritance that you'll learn about in the lesson PDF, which has to do with linked genes, or genes that are on the same chromosome. Be sure to check it out before you take the lesson assessment. Next time, we'll look at a special case of gene linkage that happens on the 23rd pair of human chromosomes. These are often called X and Y, and the genes on those chromosomes determine whether you are born a male or female. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey!